pace, and then we're going to just let Holy Spirit lead. This is really fun to be able to read the scripture, and I've been really wrestling with God. What is it that you're trying to do? I know we're an equipping center. I know the vision is to equip the saints through the work of the ministry, that we can become fruit bearers, you know, as we're using and exercising the gifts of the Spirit. But what does it look like? You know, God spoke to me a while back when we formed the Rock of the Harbor Church and Equipping Center, that we would be different than a lot of churches, because it was going to be a place where people could be nurtured and grow in the use of the gifts so they can be fruit bearers for God. And so we've not departed from the vision. You know, Tuesday night we continue to kind of rotate that. The Lord actually spoke about our house here as our Sunday gathering, that once we grew to 150 in number, that there would be a rotation of the pulpit. Well, we started rotating the pulpit prematurely. It was meant to be that I would speak until we grew to 150 in number, and then the pulpit would rotate. But I know God is gracious. He's not looking for what's wrong with us. He's looking for what's right with us. And if we don't know that, we'll look for what's wrong with others instead of what's right with them. And that's what gives place to the critical spirit that comes to destroy the work that God is trying to build. So God showed me this really clearly. He said, if people know how much they're loved, then they'll naturally feel safe to practice. If they don't know how much they're loved, then there will be an insecurity where they'll feel like they have to prove who they are. And that's what brings selfish ambition, comparison, and even gives birth to jealousy, which destroys the work of the Lord. So I just want to set the pace for what God is doing here. We're an equipping center. Our goal is really simple. We want to equip the saints to do the work of the ministry. So when the Lord said equip the saints, he actually sees you as a saint, even though you don't feel like one. This is good news. I don't feel like a saint most of the time. I'm just a goofy guy that loves Jesus. I am sold out, though. I'm not perfect, but I'm a work in progress. And I don't actually feel like I'm a very good leader most of the times. But God says to me, he says, as long as you follow the leader. And who's the leader?
Jesus.
Okay, so if I'm your leader, I'll probably let you down. But if Jesus is your leader, oh, he'll never leave you. He'll never forsake you. He's a good provider. He's one who blesses, who advances, who lifts up, who builds, who rebuilds. You know, and so we can put the emphasis on Jesus. I don't want you to put me in the place of Jesus. I'm just a guy who loves Jesus, and I'm here to make disciples of all nations. And so if you're here and you feel led to be a part of this work at the Rock of the Harbor Church and Equipping Center, then just know you will find your place. But you have to sometimes commit to something before you be placed. And we want you to be placed by the Lord and in the right season and in the right order, in the right function, in the right capacity. So if you've been feeling like you're sitting and you feel like, gosh, I want to do more, just continue to participate. The Lord will put you in the right place, and things will just work from that place. You'll be nurtured, and you will grow, and you will develop in the Lord's timing. Amen? But this is not necessarily where every single person should get up and speak. Sometimes people are just like, man, I got to speak. No, you need to do what you're doing right wherever you are. How are you in the grocery store? How are you in the workplace? How are you in what you're already doing? Are you out there shining your light? Are you preaching the gospel wherever you are to every living creature? Some people are like, I should be preaching. Well, maybe you should, but maybe you should just practice on the trees. He said, all creation declare the glory. You know what I mean? If you can get it right for the trees, okay, then you can probably get it right more often. And just practice makes perfect. Just preach wherever you are. Proclaim the good news. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Okay. So they worship together. It says here in 46, Acts 2, 46, it says this. They worship together at the temple each day. Guys, I am so excited for us to have our first building. I know we're going to have multiple facilities, but God is about to give us a building. He told me, and I believe it. Many people have confirmed it, so I'm convinced that he wants to give us a building. But do we need to have a building in order to do this? No, we don't have to have a building, because you are the temples of the Holy Spirit. He made you his home. His dwelling place is you, in Jesus' name. And when we come together, we're a bunch of temples ready for a heavenly party. So look what it says. They worshiped together at the temple. Now, there was a place where they gathered, and that's important. But he said each day. So each day, gosh, that sounds tiring, right? Every single day? Each day? No, it wasn't tiring, because they were renewing their strength. They were empowering one another. They were walking in a revelation of a need to be in fellowship and to develop. friendships that were strong and not just surface. We want to go deep with Christ, and we want to go deep with one another and each of you. And I'm excited about going deeper. Here it says, they worship together at the temple. Do you know when we raise up Jesus this way, we get connected this way. When we lift up Jesus this way and our worship goes this way, we naturally can connect with one another. If we don't worship Jesus together this way, it's really hard to connect with one another. And this is something he was showing me. So he said they met in homes for the Lord's Supper. So they were doing the Lord's Supper. They were taking communion together. And then they shared their meals with great joy and generosity. Come on, guys. This is good news. I want to be able to meet every day. Now, this facility is not open every day, but in our facility that we're about to occupy, guess what? We're going to be able to have regular meetings, which brings a greater capacity for the pulpit to be used throughout the week. And I promise you, I do not want to speak 7 days a week, which means many of you are going to be pulled out of the seat. And some of you have been feeling stirred, like, I got to do something. Well, get ready. Something's about to happen, and it's good. Your voice will be heard in just the right capacity at just the right time. God is never late. If he's been making you sit, it could be that it's just like Psalm 23. He makes us lie down. Why? Well, because we wouldn't lie down on our own. Well, why wouldn't we? I don't know. It could be anything. But God says, go sit for a little while, and let's see how you do. Well, why don't you pray today? Oh, that person who's frustrating you, how about if you intercede for them? Become their prayer warrior partner. Well, but I don't want to do that. Well, then you're rebellious. So God's like, no, I don't want you to be of the spirit of witchcraft, which is rebellion, right? I want you to craft with me as a co-creator by praying because I honor the prayers of the righteous. Your prayers are effective. So look what he says here. All the while praising God and enjoying. So this is what they were doing. They were hanging out daily. They were worshiping together daily. They were going into each other's homes and having supper. They were sharing meals and communion. And then they shared things with each other. And it was joyous for them to do that with a generous heart. And look what it says here. All the while, they were praising God. I like that. And enjoying the goodwill of all the people. All the people enjoying the goodwill. It doesn't actually say here that they were criticizing one another. It doesn't actually say here that they were looking for what was wrong and then telling their friends about it. It doesn't actually say here that they were gossiping and slandering and trying to sow discord among them, which was forbidden in the gospel. No, it says right here. All the while they were praising God and enjoying the goodwill of all the people, and each day the Lord added to their fellowship those who were being saved. Guys, this is good news. So Jesus is really just trying to pour out his spirit on people who are hungry and who want to have more of God, or who are, oh, I need to go to another scripture here. Okay, chief cornerstone. How many people know that in Acts 4, when it talks about Zerubbabel, it says here, it says that the stone that the builders rejected has become the chief cornerstone. The stone that they rejected has become the chief cornerstone. I think this is amazing. So Jesus comes to his own. They receive him not. And what happens? He becomes the chief cornerstone. Guys, when he said, on this rock I will build my church and the gates of hell will not prevail against it, what he's saying is, when it's built on the foundation of Jesus as the chief cornerstone, everything else begins to line up. And what I'm believing God for is that he will give us a strategy to maximize every single person who wants to serve the Lord, not so they would be glorified, so that he would be glorified. If you're jealous when somebody's used of God, you have an insecurity problem. And that insecurity comes from lack of understanding identity. And identity is about what God says you are. If you believe the lie about who you are, then now you feel like you have something to prove. All you have to do to change it is just go, I'm not going to believe that anymore. I am not an orphan. I am accepted by God. I am approved in the Beloved. I am a part of the family of God. It doesn't get any better than being a child of God. You have a heavenly Father that will never leave you. He'll never forsake you. He predestined and foreknew every single person. And he himself, the chief cornerstone, is establishing the plumb line. It's in the hand of Zerubbabel. He's saying, I'm going to plumb this thing. I'm going to plumb it. I'm going to put it in order. I'm going to plumb this thing. It is going to be perfectly lined up with the target of my heart, my goal, my plan for you. It will be fulfilled because I'm never late. I'm always right on time. This is about timing, the timing of the Lord. It's relevant. Some of you have been feeling like you're in a season of hiding and retreating and you've been criticized. Let me say this. If you've been sitting at the feet of Jesus, you didn't miss out on anything. Get ready to be used. Get ready to be used of the Lord. This is going to be another story. Another story that will give him glory. So I just want to encourage you, if you need a breakthrough right now, the Lord is your breakthrough.
Amen.
If you need a breakthrough, if you're feeling lonely and you feel like, gosh, I need a friend, there is a friend that sticks closer than a brother. He is with you. He watches you. He smiles over you. He's not looking for what you're about to do wrong. He's looking to empower you to do things right. When you think of him, you think on him, you think like him, and then through the mind of Christ, you can do what Christ said that you could do. And that's just a good news story. That's a good news story. You're going to be able to do what he promised that you could do. I mean, that's a beautiful thing. And you're not going to miss out. And you're not going to miss out. You're not late, and neither is he. He's marked you for unprecedented, unmerited favor, meaning you could never have earned it, so he just gave it to you. It's called righteousness. And now that you are that, you can become that. Because you can't become what you don't know you are. So get ready to let God shine through you. Some of you have been asking for jobs. Well, guess what? In the kingdom of heaven, there's no shortage of jobs. There's jobs and more jobs. Some of you are believing for job transfers, accelerations, promotions, advancements. I want to just say, at the feet of Jesus, those things will occur for you. But you can't go after a system. You got to go after the one who lords the system. It's Jesus, Jesus, Jesus. Come to his feet and sit at his feet and in desperation cry out to him. He already knows your name. And say, what do you want from me, Jesus? I just want to serve you, Jesus. He sent me to a church this morning and it was so funny. God just says, I want you to go to this place. And I'm like, okay, you know. And I wasn't scheduled to speak there. Last Sunday I was speaking in City Central and I had a really good time in Tacoma. And this time I was over in another place in Tacoma. And I said, Lord, what am I supposed to do? And he said, oh, I just want you to be there. And I'm like, okay. And then I was there and he told me where to sit. And then I sat where he told me to sit. And sometimes it feels really good just to know that you're in the sweet spot of the safety of his divine will. If you know you're where you're supposed to be, let him grow you where you're planted. But first plant at his feet, so then you will know what is the good, perfect, and acceptable will of the Lord. And then from that place, when the enemy comes to try to challenge whether or not you heard from God, you can go, ha, 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 thank you, Lord, that you said this. Thank you, God, that you promised this. I was just reading Mick's book. I was on the boat, and I was hanging out with Jesus this morning for a little bit before I came here. And I'm reading about this beautiful love, this love of Jesus, how God took a situation and brokenness and desperation. I was laughing. I think it was like page 75. I was reading about the cold water pouring out of you. And I'm just like, this is good, man. Because what it does is it's transparent about the adversity. There's going to be trials, okay? If you think you're going to avoid pain, you're probably not going to be a sold-out Christian. There's going to be pain, but it's going to be used for his purpose. If you endure some suffering, consider it all joy! Because he's preparing in you the character and the fruit of perseverance. And many of you have endured and you have suffered and you have sat at the feet of Jesus and you have cried out from desperation and said, Lord! And he heard every single cry. He heard every word, every stroke of your pen. He saw every tear and he held it in his hand as a memory of what he's now motivated to do in your life. Get ready. Because heaven is open for business and there's plenty. It's just fun, man. So fun. Somebody's getting healed right now. This is great. He heals all sickness and disease. You know, you gotta get good at laughing at the devil. By the way, laughter really messes with the spirit, the spirit of religion or the religious spirit. The religious spirit says, why are they laughing? That's not appropriate. But anyway, Jesus laughed all the time. He was full of joy. Why do you think he said the joy of the Lord is your strength? Pleasing God actually causes you to become strong, making him laugh. I think it's funny. He laughs over you. Did you know sometimes when you make a mistake, you might perceive that he's like going, oh, you bad sinner. And the reality is he's going, oh, look at my little child. They fell over. Let me help them. You're like, oh, I'm so terrible. And the Lord's like, but there's no condemnation in me. Let me dust you off. Just get back in the race. But I totally failed, Lord. He said, you didn't fail unless you quit. And then you start stepping because you got courage again, and you're like, man, I'm going to be strong and courageous. He said, those who, renew their strength and mount up on wings as eagles and walk and not faint and run and not grow weary, and you're walking around, I don't think I'm making any progress. It all looks the same. And then the Lord goes, did you just take a step? Well, yes, Lord, I took a step. Well, then you're one step closer.
That's right.
But Lord, everything looks the same. Well, that's because I'm doing something. Just keep stepping and you won't fail. But Lord, don't I have to do this and that and the other thing? No. I didn't ask you to go save the world in a day. I asked you to take a step right now. Will you do that? But Lord, I'm not like so-and-so. How come I don't have what they have? Who cares? Yeah. You're a child of God. Get over yourself. If you're new here, I'm not always like this. I just feel like God's put something in my spirit. And he's just showed me, man. If we would just get over ourselves, we would be on to him and things present and things to come. We're narcissistic as a society, man. It's like, hey, man, I gotta put another picture of Facebook up there so everyone can see all 12 of them. Because now, unless you pay for the advertising, only a few people are going to see it anyway. Whoa, you're going to put $40-$50 a month in there if you want to be like all your friends to see you. The Lord says, I don't need you to take another picture of yourself, okay? And don't post that picture with so-and-so because you want to look good, okay? It's not about you and it's not about him either. It's about me, okay? Oh, Lord, I'm sorry. I forgive you. I forgive me. I forgive everybody. Hallelujah. Oh, my goodness. Oh, we'll talk about me. We'll talk about mine. We'll talk about number one. Me, my. What I go on to see. I love talking about you, Yuri. But occasionally. Oh, my goodness. Oh, my goodness. It's so funny. It's like the Lord's just like, don't you know who you are already? I've been telling you for years. You're amazing. I love you. You can't screw it up. My mercy endures. Whoa. That's really all I have. I just want to a child of God, you don't even have to do anything. You can just sit there. I can just sit there too. And sometimes I'll just sit there.